This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takacs, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takacs, your show host. Our guest on this Thriving Dentist Show is my friend, Dr. Philip Gordon. And we're going to talk about all things dental implants, and in particular, we're going to talk about how to successfully get started with dental implants in your practice. You know, Philip has been down a wonderful journey himself in his own practice, where he has a practice in the Kansas City area, where dental implants are an important part of his practice. And he's going to share the wisdom that he has gained and with the eye towards helping you successfully get started with dental implants. But before we get to that interview, here's another top clinical tip with Dr. Leanne Brady.
So in our top clinical tip today, I want to talk about zirconia. And pretty much across the board in dentistry, we think of zirconia as our highest strength ceramic. But one of the things that most dentists that I talk to don't know is there's more than one kind of zirconia, and that the strength of zirconia is actually a really broad range. So we tend to think of it in the numbers around 900 megapascals, 1,000, 1,400 megapascals. But there's zirconia that's also at 500 megapascals. And so how do you know what you're getting? So when you think about zirconia, a really easy way to think about it is the prettier it is, the weaker it is. The uglier it is, the stronger it is. So the zirconia that's up at 1,400 megapascals is that totally opaque, totally white zirconia that you can see only if you flip a bridge over and you look down on the inside, the side that's going to actually be up against the preps. If it's really pretty zirconia, so what we call aesthetic zirconia, translucent zirconia, that could be down as low in flexural strength as 500 to 700 megapascals. So why is that important that we know that there is a difference? Because almost always when we ask for zirconia restoration on a laboratory prescription, we're asking for it because we want it strong. And so specifically getting the right kind of zirconia is important. So especially if you are doing that lower second molar, you're doing it on a patient who is really tough on their teeth, which is the way I like to talk about patients at high occlusal risk. They're just harder on their teeth than other patients are. You may want to specify that on your laboratory prescription. So one of the things for me is that I called up my laboratory when I first learned about this and I said, hey, talk to me about the different kinds of zirconia that I can select. And so they gave me not a choice of 100, but basically three kinds of zirconia that they're routinely returning my restorations in and approximately what the strengths of those were, so that if I really do want a particular one, I want the strongest one, I can actually note that on the laboratory prescription. So as a general rule, the prettier it is, the weaker it is, the less pretty it is, the stronger it is. And a really great thing to know is what type of zirconia is your laboratory routinely sending you when you're doing those single unit cases, and is there a type you could ask for that's stronger, or maybe a type that you could ask for that's prettier in situations where you actually would preference for the stronger material or the prettier zirconia. So next time you fill out a laboratory prescription and you just simply check that box for a zirconia restoration, understand that there's more to it and that you might want to ask another question or two.
Wasn't that another great clinical tip from Dr. Leanne Brady? Before we get to our interview, I want to talk a little bit about our upcoming digital course titled Busting Loose from Insurance Dependence. You know, when I talk to dentists all over the country, I hear that the most pressing concern is third-party intrusion and how participating with PPOs is radically affecting doctors' profitability. I wanted to be part of the solution, so I put together this digital course called Busting Loose from Insurance Dependence as a way for you to regain control of your fees. You know, of all the decisions that Paul and I have made in our leadership of our practice, Life Smiles, the most important decision we have made was to break loose from insurance dependence and develop a model where we've successfully been able to go out of network, and this has radically improved our profitability. You know, here's what I want you to think of. Recently, I received an email from a dentist saying that last year he had over $500,000 in insurance PPO write-offs, over $500,000. From this moment forward, I want you to think of those insurance adjustments as a marketing expense. Now, why would that be a marketing expense? Because you are paying the insurance company to provide you patients. Does that make sense? Well, the only honest answer to that is it depends. What I'd encourage you to do is to compare your cost of those adjustments with the cost of developing a comprehensive marketing plan. You may discover that it's significantly less expensive for you to develop your own comprehensive marketing plan and get the added benefits of patients choosing you for reasons other than you're on their plan. That was our case, and we have been able to successfully break free from insurance dependence, and I'm going to help you do the very same thing. Here's some things that we're going to cover in that digital course. A specific 7-point plan to successfully go out of network with PPO plans. How to develop a comprehensive marketing plan to consistently attract quality new patients. Comprehensive verbal skills for you and your team members. In particular, verbal skills on how to answer that question, do you accept my insurance? How to reduce your insurance dependency yet remain patient-friendly in the process? How to evaluate your readiness to bust loose from insurance dependence? That's a very important topic. A lot of things need to be in place, and you need to be able to evaluate your readiness to bust loose from insurance dependence. We'll talk about how to master payment options so patients can afford the very best care. We'll talk about the benefits of an in-office patient membership plan and how to use this plan to attract a universe of patients who do not have dental insurance. Finally, we'll talk about how to retain as many existing patients as possible when you go out of network. I want to encourage you to come join us for that digital course, Busting Loose from Insurance Dependence. It starts on Tuesday, June 5th. Don't worry, you don't have to be there when it starts. All of the information is available 24/7, 365. Simply click the link in the show notes. The show notes are on thrivingdentist.com, and you can register for that course and get more information about our digital course, Busting Loose from Insurance Dependence. Now on to this week's interview. In the intro, I mentioned that my guest today was Dr. Philip Gordon. Hey, Philip, how are you?
I'm great, Gary. Thanks for having me on the show.
Hey, man, it's great to hear your voice. We had the privilege of spending some time together face-to-face a couple weeks ago. That was fun, wasn't it?
We did, yeah. We met for the second time here in Kansas City, Hedge Out, and got some work done on the business. So real happy about how things are going there.
You know, our topic today, we're going to talk about how to successfully get started with dental implants in your practice. And I could not think of a better guest to help us navigate that than Philip, because he's been on this journey now for over 10 years, and he has some amazing wisdom to share with our listeners. So, man, this is going to be fun.
Yeah, I'm real excited. I think, you know, there's a lot of neat things going on in implant dentistry, and there's never been a better time for people to kind of get in and get going with that. And I'm excited to share what I'm doing with that and hopefully get others involved.
You think there might be some people out there in the world that we could benefit through implant dentistry? You think there might be a few?
I think there's a lot of patients that could benefit. And there's a lot of dental practices that I think could get the benefit of providing that care, either you know, financially and the rewards of just helping other people, I think are limitless at this point in our, you know, where we're at as in a society and where dental implants are at.
Yeah, it's exciting. You know, Philip and I, our worlds cross paths in a number of different ways, if I can share that with our listeners. First of all, you probably know this, but if not, it's good for you to know that Philip is also a podcaster. You're in the podcasting fraternity, right?
I am, yeah. So I got started podcasting, I guess it was about September of 16 is when my first one launched. And I think I reached out to you that summer and said, hey, Gary, I love your podcast. I want to do something of my own. How can you help? And you got me going, and it's been great ever since.
Well, if you listen to this show, I can assure you that you will love Philip's podcast. It's called Dental Implant Practices. And guess what it's about? Yep. It's about dental implants and all things dental implants. And awesome. You have some great guests on the show. You share some great insight. And I'll put a link to your podcast in the show notes. But I just want to go on record as saying that if you're a listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, you will also enjoy listening to Philip's podcast, Dental Implant Practices. Another one of the spheres that our worlds kind of collide is that Philip is also a client. He's a client of mine, and we're having some fun times in your practice. We are taking what is already a really good practice and making it even better. And we've had the privilege of, we got started together this past fall and really doing some fun things together. Philip built you built your ideal office in, and you moved into it in a physical office I'm talking about, in June of 17. So that was, about 9 months ago. That was a fun process to get in that ideal space, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. You know, I had my office and we were growing and I was looking to move, and I found a spot that I'd wanted after a lot of thinking and analysis and all that, you know. So we did a build out, renovated a spot that was open, and we've been here almost a year now. And I'm really good at trying to organize my thoughts, and I'm really good at the creative side, and I know where I want to go. But logistically, you know, I just at times felt like I needed help getting to the next level with all the moving parts and all the details. So that's why I gave you a call on that front. I knew, you're a pro at doing that for people. And, I want to maximize my space, my team, my energy, and really make the most out of where I'm going with things so that I can, focus on the big picture and the dreaming and the goal setting and the dentistry, and then have you help me kind of get, the team on board and get all the, the game plan laid out in front of me so that things are working in the right direction. So I'm excited about what we're doing so far and excited about what the future's got for us.
Yeah. Philip practices in Kansas City, or the Kansas City area, and has a great office. We'll talk more about that as we go along. But, you know, Philip, what I think might be useful for our listeners to kind of start with is, would you mind sharing your backstory? And as you go through that backstory, talk about how you became interested in placing and restoring dental implants.
Yeah, great. You know, my story is probably very similar to a lot of other people's and very relatable. I had an influence in dentistry in my life. My father was a dentist, so I know a lot of us get into dentistry for a lot of reasons. But it's usually, you know, we have a good experience with dentistry and think, okay, I want to get into the field. And when I graduated in 2009 from dental school, I joined the practice with my father and was working with him full time there. We're doing a lot of cosmetic and restorative dentistry, and I thought that's kind of where my focus would be doing cosmetics. And the first couple of years I was just focused on getting into dentistry, learning how to do the basics, and patient care and all of that, getting up to speed and getting my clinical skills where they need to be and my leadership skills where they need to be. But as that developed, I noticed that my passion was really more in surgery, extractions. And I was very curious about this dental implant part of dentistry that was growing. Yet I knew very little about it, unfortunately. When I graduated dental school in 2009 from the University of Missouri in Kansas City, there wasn't much emphasis on general dentist role in implant dentistry. We were taught that general dentists really shouldn't be placing implants, that we should be restoring them, although they really didn't teach us even how to restore implants all that well. So I knew there was more out there for me. I just didn't know where to go. I didn't have the training on it. I didn't know what CE to take. I didn't know which implant systems were good. I didn't really know how to treatment plan for them. Cone beam was just coming more and more available at the time, but I had no training on how to read a cone beam. And so there was a lot of holes in, where I wanted to be and where I was currently. And so that kind of got me on my challenge to say, okay, I want to figure this thing out and break through all those barriers that at the time general dentists had getting into implant dentistry. And so that kind of sparked my journey and my passion and kind of led me down this route now.
In a way, you were a trailblazer in regards to your own journey, because your dad, and by the way, I had the privilege of meeting your dad when I was back there a couple of weeks ago. What a great guy. Love your dad. And did your dad place implants in his practice?
You know, he didn't know. He had been through some of the MISH training in the years back. And at the time, really, they were just focused on the kind of treatment planning and restorative part with some of the training that he had gotten. So he had no formal training in implants either. You know, he graduated 30 years before me. And so, of course, you can imagine he had zero exposure to that in dental right. school.
And I know your dad loves cosmetic dentistry, and he's a very mm-hmm. accomplished aesthetic dentist. And I know that's his passion is cosmetics in mm-hmm. the same way that your passion is implants. But back to the fact that you were a trail, you had to kind of blaze your own trail because you didn't have a guidance from your dad or other mentors that said this is what to do. So you kind of had to go out there and blaze your own trail.
Yeah, you know, I found there was a lot of barriers for dentists, right? For general dentists, it's you know, I was seeing in my practice there is a lot of treatment coming in where old failing root canal teeth or people missing teeth or teeth that were broken down so far we just couldn't fix them even with good conventional crown and bridge and root canals and all of that. And so I thought, okay, there's got to be a better way to do some of this. And implant dentistry really needs to be a bigger part of our practice. You know, and so I tried working with numerous specialists in the Kansas City metro. You know, we have a big city, and so we have lots of resources for that. We have great specialists in Kansas City. That wasn't necessarily the problem, but what I was finding is sometimes the kind of old referral chain was broken. You know, half of the patients that we would send to get implant referrals to specialists just wouldn't go, right? And maybe the half of the patients that did went wouldn't go through a treatment. So, you know, there was a step off at every level of case acceptance and commitment. And I feel, okay, we've got to do something different here, right? I know that patients need and want this, but it's not happening for some reason. So I thought, okay, you know, I need to take this challenge upon myself to figure out a better way to get patients into the care they need and at the same time fulfill this challenge and passion of surgery that I'd had. So I thought, okay, I'm going to figure this thing out. I'm going to figure the education piece out, where to go, who's doing what systems are available, how to integrate technology, you know, putting together workflows with surgical guides and all of that. But it was still somewhat challenging at the time because, most of the major implant systems at the time were not general dentist friendly. And there was still a lot of pushback from specialists about, you know, general dentist placing and restoring implants. So, kind of had to go through some of those barriers and struggles and kind of get to the truth on my own. So,
You know, Philip, you made a comment that I want to reinforce. You said it's frustrating when you make a referral to the patient, you know, to go see a specialist. And this is someone you have a lot of belief in and a lot of support, you know, from the specialist. And it turns out the patient won't go. And we've had that happen in my own practice. And, you know, I think it's kind of a backhanded compliment in some ways, because the patient's saying that, no, I like you guys. I don't want to go anywhere else. I like you, you know,
yeah,
I like,
exactly.
I like Kelly and Kaylee, your team members up front. Yeah. And, I like your team and I like you, doc, you know, don't let it go to your head, but I like you. And, you know, I don't want to go anywhere else. And,
you know, there is that trust factor and there is that, you know, relationship you already have. And so I think, you know, part of them is saying, okay, well, why can't we do this here? And I think, I wasn't able to offer that at the time because I didn't want to do things I wasn't competent in. Right. And I didn't want to put myself in a situation that, would lead to compromised care for the patient. And so I thought, you know, I need to figure this thing out. If I'm going to do it, I need to do it right. So, you know, that really sparked my journey to say, okay, I need to get to the bottom of this. I don't just want to go to one or two courses that maybe a, implant company puts on and think I know it all. I need to figure out, you know, where the information is. And so,
well, wait a minute, you didn't take that Saturday morning course, you know, the one for 2 hours from 8 in the morning till 10 in the morning and become an expert in dental implants. You didn't take that course?
You know, I did take that course. Yes. However, that was the one, the first of many. And I think I tell people the weekend courses that an implant manufacturer may put on or a study club may put on are great. They're usually what sparks people's interest in implant dentistry, but that is not where it should stop. So
it's the beginning, not the end.
Yeah. So I'm all for that because you need to dip your toe in the water and say, okay, is this right for me? Do I even want to go down this path? But once you have said, okay, I want to do this, let me learn more. That should be the beginning of your journey, not the end of your journey. So
I want to paint a scenario here for you, Philip. So, you know, we have listeners all over the world. We have listeners in 162 countries, and, really we have listeners at every stage of their career. Some doctors, in fact, some are in dental school at this point. We even have some pre-dental students listening to this, but you know, we have dental students, then we have early career dentists, we have mid-career dentists, and we have some wonderful late career dentists that are passionate about dentistry. So what I want you to do, imagine that there's a listener and the listener is thinking, gosh, I really want to get into implant dentistry, but it's like, I don't even know where to begin. You know, it's like overwhelming. So, you know, over the last 10 years, you've invested a massive amount of time and money, frankly. I wonder if you've ever tallied how much you've invested in your CE, but it's, I bet that's a huge number. Maybe you don't want to do that.
I'd rather not.
But
more
frankly,
than my dental school education almost.
and I bet your wife doesn't want to know how many days you've spent chasing CE, because that's a massive number as well.
Yeah.
That's, right.
That's a whole nother conflict in and of itself. The time and money are an investment. But right. You have to look at that as, much like your dental school education or anything else, an investment in yourself that pays itself forward. And, you know, investing in clinical skills and education and technology, you know, is always a good return. So,
well, you've, as I mentioned, you spend a massive amount of time and money in knowledge and investing in yourself, with the idea of successfully incorporating implants into your practice. Can you talk about some of the highlights of this 10-year plus journey? If you had to go back and play the highlight reel, what are some highlights? Because you've got, and before we even do that, I want to just state, you have an amazing practice in Kansas City. I would describe it, and Philip, correct me if you would describe it differently, but here's how I would describe your practice. I would describe your practice as a general dental practice with a strong focus on placing and restoring implants. Does that correctly describe it?
Absolutely. You know, we are a general dental office, and I don't want to exclude myself from that. However, we really try to focus on implant dentistry. Two reasons for that, partially because that's where my passion is, and secondly, that's kind of where we've positioned our practice and where we want to be. With the type of people in the community that's around us. So that's a good way to describe us. You know, I do a lot of smile design and veneers and crowns. But, you know, if I had my choice, I'd be spending a lot, you know, most of my time placing and restoring implants and, you know, eventually bringing somebody else in soon to help kind of do some of the other work. So,
well, in fact, if I can can I share my, you know, peek behind the curtain on the coaching side of your practice
sure.
for just a minute, Philip.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I'm sharing this with our listeners. One of our plans as we grow, we're strengthening the hygiene department, the hygiene component of Philip's practice. And as the practice becomes busier, we'll be bringing an associate dentist on board to pick up more of some of the everyday general dentistry and shifting some of that from Philip's schedule to the associate doctor. And then the void that's created by opening up some of that on Philip's schedule, we're going to fill with more placing and restoring implants. And I can see a day in the future where most of your time will be spent doing placing and restoring implants. Maybe the second component would be the cosmetic dental side of it, which mm-hmm. also doing some beautiful veneer cases or restorative cases that involve aesthetics. And then having a support with an associate doctor to pick up some of the everyday general dentistry. That's kind of where we're headed. Well, let's come back to this. Share some highlights of this 10-year plus journey if you had to make a highlight reel of some of the highlights.
Yeah, you know, for me, when I think about some of the highlights, it's, you know, part of it is I think about the people along the way, because I think, you know, implant dentistry is a great field, but you know, when I think about the positive experiences I had, I think about maybe courses I've taken or individuals I've run into along the way that have just made an impact in my learning along the way, some of the mentors that I've had. And so, you know, for me early on, it took somebody kind of saying, okay, this kid has interest, he has passion, but let's get him on the right track. You know, for me, it was going to courses and finding who was willing to share, you know, and find out who's really willing to teach from the heart and not really just kind of putting their best cases up there and telling you that's what every day their practice is like. You know, some of those people, like a Justin Moody, who, you know, has really opened up his teaching facility and is sharing what he's doing, I think are, you know, kind of people that really have been where you've been, you know, before and can kind of see where you're heading and can kind of be there to coach you along the way. So I think those are the kind of people that I tend to drift towards.
Hey, let's give a nice shout out to Justin. Justin is a mutual friend of ours, and he is doing some amazing things in the teaching dental implant world. And, you know, he's just as genuine as they come. You know, for those of you that are thinking, well, you know, I can't develop much of an implant component in my practice because I'm not in downtown Chicago or I'm not in Manhattan or I'm not in Atlanta or Seattle or Los Angeles. So I probably can't do much here. I'm saying this with my tongue firmly planted in my cheek. Justin is in the implant epicenter of the world, right? Right, Philip? Right?
He is. Yeah. He's at ground zero and he built it from ground zero. It wasn't something that he walked into a practice and said, this is an amazing practice and I'm just going to keep it going. You know, he didn't join a implantology team. He kind of built it from the ground up in an area where, you know, you might not think possible.
I'm sure our listeners are thinking, well, he's probably in the Buckhead district of Atlanta, right?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Or he's on the Upper East Side of Manhattan or he's got to be in Beverly Hills, right?
Yeah.
Or mm-hmm. West Palm Beach, Florida. That's where he is, right? West Palm Beach. No. Yeah. He's in, you ready for it? Wait for it. Sioux Falls, South Dakota.
Yeah.
What?
Absolutely. So I thought, you know, if this guy can do it here, I can do it in Kansas City. I mean, we've got at least 10 times many people, right? You know, another one of my big journeys was, you know, going out and seeing different facilities. So, you know, I've toured the Implant Direct facility and seen where those implants are made. I've toured the Nobel BioCare implant facility and seen where those implants are made. I've toured the Glidewell facility and seen where those implants are made.
That's Jim Glidewell has done some cool stuff, hasn't he?
He's done some amazing stuff. So meeting those people there, I've toured where BioHorizons implants are made. So seeing that at ground level, meeting the people who helped create those implants, seeing the process, you know, has given me a bigger understanding of the field. You know, taking a AAID Maxi course through the American Academy of Implant Dentistry with Dr. John Menichetti, that was a huge highlight for me because that's a year-long continuum with over 300 hours of, you know, learning from many different masters of implantology. You know, really gives you a well-rounded education. It gives you a deeper respect for some of the academies, like the AAID and the ICOI. You know, those were huge turning points in my career when I was ready for them. And I'd be remiss if, you know, if not talking about some other people, you know, learning from some of the greats, you know, meeting and going visiting Jack Hahn in his office, who is the creator of the Hahn implant, but he also invented the Nobel Replace implant. So he's been inventing and placing implants for close to 40 years now. So that was, you know, definitely a highlight for me.
You know, we lost someone that was just a wonderful influence in the implant world, Dr. Carl Misch. Mm-hmm. Sadly, Carl passed away last year, but it would be remiss not to name Carl as a leader in the implant world. Would you agree?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you know, one of the cornerstones of you know, implantology. And so, you know, there's lots of people who have kind of taken me in and shown me you know, not only what, not just what they could do, but they've shown me what I can do. And I think that's what's more important. It's one thing to say, hey, here's all this great work I can do. Aren't I fancy? Here's what I can do. It's another thing for someone to mentor you and say, let me bring out the potential in you and let me help teach you who you can become. And I think those are the kind of people you want to be around.
Philip, you probably remember back in grade school, you were introduced to a historic individual in the sciences by the name of Isaac Newton. Do you remember? Mm-hmm. It was probably, I don't know, probably grade school that you first heard the name Isaac Newton, right?
Yep.
Can I share a quote from Isaac Newton that kind of amplifies what you just said?
Sure.
It goes like this. If I can see farther, it's because I've stood on the shoulders of giants.
Yes, exactly.
Isn't that a quote? Yep. And really, doesn't that sort of characterize your journey?
You know, it does. I had some exposure to some great people early on. You know, I've known Paul Homily for a number of years, and
you know, Paul's a neighbor of mine now. Yeah. You know, Paul's out here in Scottsdale now, and Paul's been,
yeah, I know he is.
Yeah, he's been a friend of mine forever, and I'm so excited that, you know, we can meet face to face now, because for many years he was in North Carolina, and mm-hmm. It was a cross country flight. Well, now, I mean, we can meet at Starbucks.
I love it. And you know, what's great about Paul is when he was a practicing dentist, you know, he was one of the early adopters of implant dentistry and was placing implants in the 80s when you know, people really didn't even know about them.
Right.
You know, and he was a go-getter from day one. And so, you know, learning from people like that who kind of set the stage, and like I said, kind of standing on the shoulders of the giants who were you know, humble enough to teach me and show me what they learn. And kind of lift me up and see the potential in me and help kind of share everything that they did. And so I've tried to use that and say, okay, how can I, at the point I'm at now, try to, take what people have given and invested in me and try to help, kind of give that and invest in others. So,
right.
You know, that's kind of the turning point where I'm at now is, you know, I have a long way to go in my career, and I'm not saying I'm necessarily the greatest at any one thing, but I'm trying to do the best that I can and put that work out for others and say, hey, you can do this too. Right. But there's gotta be some thought about how you go through it. You know, there's gotta be a process involved.
Let's
figure out what that process is for you and help kind of, you know, direct you within that.
You know, Philip, earlier when you were talking about some of the influences you've had by mentors, one of the things you identified was that some of these mentors have had a great deal of humility. In other words, they're very accomplished, but they maintain an element of humility with their work as well. And I think one of the indicators of a really, really good instructor is that they're not shy about sharing their mistakes.
Yeah.
And by the way, any instructor that ever stands there at the front of the room and says, I've never made any mistakes, they're either a liar mm-hmm. or they've never done anything.
Yeah, absolutely. Because, you know, I can tell you firsthand, my mistakes are where I've learned the most, in my career, and I've made plenty of them. Hopefully they're just not mistakes that you can't recover from. Right.
Right.
That's probably the limiting factor.
Right. Well, if you don't mind, can I put you on the spot for just a minute?
Sure. Absolutely.
So kind of in that same vein, now you've been on this 10 year journey, knowing mm-hmm. what you know now, what would you do differently if you could go back to, you know, 10 years ago, turn the clock back to 2009, knowing what you know now, what would you do differently to accelerate your path to get where you are now quicker? What would you do?
You know, what I would do is I would say, you know, getting that technology piece right away, you know, getting that cone beam technology right out of the gate, I think is important.
Yeah, because now it's, you know, I mean, really,
it's kind of a must.
Well, it's standard of care. I mean,
it is, yeah.
It's standard of care. Heaven forbid that something would ever go south and you'd have a board complaint or a legal issue. And the question came up, doctor, did you get a 3D image scan?
Yeah. Yeah. So I think jumping into that technology piece first, I think I kind of waited for when the situation dictated that I do it. And I think it should have been the other way around. Okay. Get the technology and then facilitate the dentistry. I was trying to get enough dentistry to kind of justify the technology. And of course, you know, but that would be one thing I'd recommend, is because even if you're not placing implants, having a cone beam in your practice is invaluable. You know, another thing I would recommend would be, you know, getting to some of these introductory courses from a couple different people, right? Let's go to some 101 courses that, you know, maybe take three or four in a year that are from different approaches, right? Don't just get all your information at one spot. So I think,
isn't that, Phil, pardon my, you know, as you know, I'm not a clinician. Mm-hmm. I see a lot of dentists getting their implant education one-dimensionally from a mm-hmm. manufacturer.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that's bad. I think that could be very useful, because who mm-hmm. better to understand that technology than the manufacturer and those associated with the manufacturer. But isn't that can't that become a little bit of a one-trick pony?
It can, yeah, because they're of course their product is the best, and their you know facility is the only one that works, and their system is, you know, world renowned. But no, I think getting an education from multiple sources, I think, and learning what those sources are. So that's why I took it on myself to, you know, I tried to tour almost every implant manufacturing facility there was in the U.S. And I've tried to take CE from almost all of those places so that I could understand kind of their philosophy, and then take that and then I'll say, okay, well, that's not the only thing that's going on here. Let me get it from some other places. So I think, not just like you said, just not getting all your information from one source, right? So mm-hmm. I think that's important to think about. Okay, who can I learn from in multiple sources? And then I think getting involved with an organization, you know, like the AAID, the American Academy of Implant Dentistry, and the ICOI, the International Congress of Oral Implantology, that are organizations that are put together for the growth and expansion of implant dentistry. I think it's important to be part of things that are bigger than yourself, that have people and processes in place that are there for you to kind of learn from and grow and mature within. So I've met some amazing people at those.
And both have, correct me if I'm wrong on this, Philip, but both have fellowship. Am I using the right terminology? Fellowship yep. tracks?
Yeah, they do. Fellowship and then diplomate tracks. So So they have tracks for you to learn and I guess an end result for you to try to become a fellow or a diplomate. So there's challenges within each of those that you know, allow you to push yourself and kind of have goals to set. But then they're also there to support you with it. You know, some of the most amazing mentors I've met have been through that. And you know, those people are giving their time and energy, usually at very little to no cost, to see that those organizations exist and that are thriving, so that the future of implant dentistry can continue to thrive.
And frankly, the barrier to entry to either of those is really low for dentists. They can just become a member and go to the annual meeting.
Yeah, those are easy to do. I mean, I think a couple $100 to become a member, go to the meeting. It's good CE, and if nothing else, you know you're fulfilling your commitments to your state, right? Just keep your license alive. But it's a good place to see, okay, whose philosophies do I align with? What type of practice setting do I want to have? Whose tricks and techniques do I want to kind of learn from? And then that's kind of how I like to view those events and kind of see what's current. And then you can take that home and digest it and say, okay, who do I want to model after? You know, what kind of things do I see myself doing with the patients that are coming into my office? And so it gives you that energy and idea spark that you need. And then they give you the guidance to stay within the boundaries of what's acceptable and current within implant dentistry.
Hey, I want to go down a fun little detour for just a second, sure. Philip. We didn't talk about this ahead of time. So pardon me for not prepping you for this, Philip. But your office is amazing. I love your office, and you gave a massive amount of thought. I followed you all through your Facebook. You know, you were posting on Facebook different aspects of your build out and things that you were doing. And there's nothing in your office that was an accident. You've designed it very, very, very intentionally. And I want to compliment you on it. You nailed the idea. I'm going to describe it in my terms. you designed an office that looks like a place I'd spend $20,000 to replace a floppy lower denture with maybe an implant supported restoration. Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But it also looks like a place that if I was a single parent school teacher on a tight budget, that I'd be comfortable in your office. Do you see it that way?
No, I do. I just didn't know that other people would.
No, I see it. And by the way, my office is very much like that as well. We want it to look like a place someone would spend $15,000 for a smile, but also very comfortable for a single parent truck driver or a single parent school teacher where they wouldn't feel like it's over the top. And I think you've done that. But there's one particular part of your design I want you to talk about, and that is your exam consultation room. Would you describe, and let me tease you a little bit, Philip. You're in Kansas City, kind of the middle of the country.
Yep.
And we have listeners all over the country. And if you're listening to this, if you up till now have never had a friend in Kansas City, you now have a friend in Kansas City, Philip Gordon.
Yep. I'm here.
I made you their friend.
Come see me.
And it's a great city. By the way, if you like baseball, get Philip to take you to a Kansas City Royals game. But you need to go to Kansas City and see his consult / exam room in person. So, Philip, I hope I'm going to extend an invitation to any of our listeners. I'm going to give Philip's email address when we finish up this interview. Reach out to him and make an excuse to go visit him in Kansas City sometime and have him show you his consult / exam room. Philip, would you describe that room? And this is where I wish we had video in the podcast, but do your best of describing it auditorially, audially, so that our listeners can kind of understand what that room's like.
Yeah. So it's kind of it happened. It was a work in progress for almost 8 years, 9 years, how this room created. And, when I built out this new office, I finally got to get it exactly how I want it. The problem with a traditional office is, okay, you know, you might bring a patient in and, okay, well, where do we start with this patient? Are they just here for a consult? Do they just want to talk? Do we need to take x-rays? Do we need to take photos? Do we need to take a scan? Does the doctor need to look in their mouth? Is that too uncomfortable? Do we need to sit down and talk financials? Are we moving back and forth between imaging rooms and consult rooms and treatment rooms? And so it's kind of like, okay, I want to have a place where I can have one new patient coordinator and have one destination and do everything we need to in there and make it spacious and luxurious and comfortable, but also efficient. So that was the kind of brainchild of all that, is like, okay, let me design the room around my process. And the process is to bring in a consult where someone's having pain or they don't like their smile or they have more dentistry going on than we know about. And so we can bring them in. My new patient coordinator can sit them down, have a nice conversation with them, take the photos right there in the room, take the x-rays right in the room, maybe get a scan. So it's really, if you take a consult room and a dental operatory and put them right next to each other and then erase the wall. So
it's kind of imagine a room that is double size.
Yeah, it's twice as big. So I have a full size operatory in there, and I have a full size consultation suite in there, and I built it. I had my architect build that, and then I just had him erase the wall on the drawing.
This is common. This type of combined consult / exam room is common in ortho offices.
Yeah.
Orthodontic offices. So doctors.
And I've actually heard that. I've never actually been in an orthodontic office since I had my braces taken off when I was 15. So,
and you weren't paying attention to it when you were 15.
Not at all. But I have heard that it's somewhat of a common thing with orthodontist offices.
But it's not common at all outside of the orthodontic world. And so if you've been in an orthodontist office that has kind of an oversized room that combines a consult room with a chair, that's what Philip has. And I want to emphasize that, pretty much that's where Keeley starts with any of your new patients.
Yeah. So
they're
we'll
not
finishing that room sometimes. Right?
This isn't just for the patient that's raising their hand saying, "Hey, I don't like my floppy lower denture. I heard you can help me with this." Certainly that's an obvious one, but
yeah,
this could be for an emergency patient as well.
Yeah, we can do anything in there. I mean, we have, I think, seven ops. So mm-hmm. we try to use this room wisely. You know, I don't want to do denture adjustments in there or filling adjustments in there. It's set up for consults or exploration of dentistry. So, you know, new patients are a great way to do that because we bring the patient in. My new patient coordinator can have time to talk with them. It's very informal. It's, you know, they can establish that relationship. Then we can take the digital photography. I have a big screen TV that hangs down in front of the chair so she can walk through the digital photography with them. They can see it. So they can stay on the dental op side of the room. I can come in, meet the patient, look in their mouth, lean them back. You know, I have a full functioning op in there. So if I need to do a sedative filling or a bite adjustment or something there, I can. I can review the mouth. I can set them up. I can you know, come up with a treatment plan right there. And then we can get up out of the dental chair and we can take two steps over and we can sit down on a consultation desk. And there's, you know, two chairs on one side of the table. And for a lot of people bring their spouse to these consultations. So it's, you know, we can move over to a non-threatening setting. We can put the instruments down. Let's get out of the mouth. Let's not be a patient. I say, you can be done being a patient now. Let's move over here. We can just talk like friends.
This is so important. And you used a term there. It's non-confrontational. It's very comfortable. I've watched this in your practice and I've watched patients in that room. And it's a very comfortable space for them, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they feel real at ease. They don't feel under the microscope.
It doesn't feel like a treatment room in the conventional sense. It could be.
No, it doesn't.
I mean, you can use it, yeah. But
it doesn't feel like a treatment room. Yeah. You know, we've got pictures and plants. I mean, it's very roomy and spacious and it's
very comfortable.
The chair faces away from all the dental stuff. So they're not looking at a bunch of instruments and it's a very comfortable room because, we're trying to make an emotional connection with the patient in that room. We're trying to get diagnostic information, but more importantly, we're trying to get, an emotional connection with them so that we can really hear their story and then understand what their needs are so that we can figure out what kind of dentistry we're going to fit to where they're at. And, some people, don't like the idea of sitting in the dental chair. And so, we can move over and sit down and talk about it.
I would say most people.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Well, kudos, man. You did an awesome job on the design of that office, in particular the design of your exam consult room. And I'm quite serious about that. I'll extend the invitation to our listeners. Reach out to Philip. I'll give you the email address later. And just talk to him about it and have him send him an email or have him take a picture of it. Come out and see him. Back on our schedule of the interview, I'll put you back on the spot here. If you had to give three tips for a dentist getting started, and that dentist could be a young dentist, could be a mid-career, could be a late career dentist. What's your best three tips for a dentist just getting started with placing and restoring implants? I'll number those and make some notes here. What would be those three tips?
Those are tricky questions and people ask me that a lot. I said, you need to get your feet in the game at some level. So I think jump in. I mean, you don't know until you, are there. Right. And I think there's a lot of people that have a lot of fear about, implant dentistry because there's a lot of unknown. Right. And the best way to get rid of that fear is to get some knowledge and experience. So, I say let's get you to a couple 101 courses where you can learn about what an implant motor is. You can learn about the drills and the sockets and the kits, and you can maybe place some implants in a plastic jaw and maybe learn how to suture on a pig jaw. And you can just get over the whole I don't even know anything, right? Because you have to start somewhere. So I think some of the implant companies are good for that. You know, Glidewell has a good course for that. Implant Direct has a good course for that. There's some very basic courses.
Gordon Christensen has a really nice overview course.
Okay, yeah.
Just a broad overview.
What is this implant world? What are all the instruments and what are all the, you know, what's all the language about? Because it's how to reflect a flap, So that would be kind of my number one. Like get out there and get to something that you think could resonate with you. The next step would be, start to learn the basics of oral surgery. Right, you need to just start extracting and grafting and suturing and laying flaps as much as possible, because those foundations of oral surgery are really where you need to start for placing implants.
Excellent.
Those skills are all going to be needed when the implants come later. So, learn those early skills of oral surgery.
Excellent.
And then align yourself with good partners. I think, too many people try to do things on their own, right? And I think you need to find some good partners to deal with. And so that, I mean, a good lab, a good implant system, a good mentorship program, a good resource for information, or, you need to find people that are reliable sources of good information and that are willing to share it with you. So I think, those three are good places to start, because you're not going to get over your head. You start with the basic courses, start with the basic procedures, and figure out who your team's going to be, right? Okay, I need to develop all these teams, right? You need a patient coordinating team. You need a cone beam partner. You need a lab partner. You need an implant partner. You need a marketing partner. So put your team together and make sure you're picking good partners for your team, because they're going to be your biggest resource for you. And you're going to need all those resources to be productive in this.
Really good. Just to recap, number one, jump in, get involved with some really great dental implants 101 courses. Just jump in, get it demystified. Number two, develop really solid oral surgery fundamentals. And number three, align yourself with some really good partners. Great, great tips. Well, Philip, I know you, as your personality, to be a giver. You're one of those people in the world that gives. And you have come up with an amazing resource. You're right in the middle right now of a very cool project that's going to be an amazing resource for dentists that are interested in implant dentistry. Would you talk about this project and kind of let our listeners know what you're up to and what's available to them?
Yeah, started the Dental Implant Practices podcast, I guess a couple years ago. And my goal from that was to get the best leaders in implantology, on the horn, and say, hey, let's get you on the hook and get some questions and let me get the best information you have and put it out there for people. Cause I thought, if I can interview 100 people and I can get the best information out of the top 100 people in implant dentistry, I'm going to have some pretty good nuggets, right? I'm going to have some pretty good connections, and I'm going to learn a lot, but I'm also going to share a lot with other people. And so that's kind of where the brainchild for the podcast came from. I thought, I'm going to surround myself with people who are better than me and smarter than me, and I'm going to learn the best that they have, and hopefully I can absorb some of that. I found out I made a lot of really good connections on the way, and so a couple years later, I'm thinking, okay, I need to expand what I'm doing, not because what I'm doing is bad, but I think there's more room for that, right? So I started the Facebook mentorship page, and I've got about 5,000 dentists that follow me on the Facebook page, where I post all of my cases and I just show you what goes on in my office on a daily basis. So sometimes it's a full arch of teeth, and sometimes it's a basic extraction and bone graft. But still, I thought, I need to do more for the dental community, because my goal for this was to break down the barriers of implant dentistry for the general dentist. And how can I help general dentists not just get into implantology, but get into implant dentistry and be successful? And I thought, I've been down this journey and I've been kicking through these doors. I've made these relationships. I have this community. How can I provide something more for them? So I'm kind of redeveloping the Dental Implant Practices platform. And I've expanded that to include a group purchasing organization, as well as I'm developing some more CE content. So those two things are going to be the launch this spring and summer of a group purchasing organization for implant dentistry. I think it's implant dentistry's first and only group purchasing organization, where I've negotiated deals with the top implant continuing education courses and the top implant manufacturers and products, to where if someone's wanting to get into implantology or they're already placing a bunch of implants, I can save you a ton of money and a ton of time, because I can streamline your process. I can expedite your growth curve, and I can get you there shorter, faster, and cheaper.
And you're agnostic when it comes to manufacturers.
Yeah, I don't necessarily get any money from these people. I'm not taking payments or anything with them. I'm not on anybody's books with any of this. And I don't necessarily care which implant system you use, but I try to pre-screen people. I try to get with partners that I know are going to give people success, right? So whether it's, yeah, you know, viral horizons.
I love your objectivity in this, because you don't come at it one-dimensionally from one manufacturer, but you come at it really at what best serves the dentist and the patient.
Yeah, exactly. I don't want to support something that I know isn't going to work for somebody, because I've had a lot of people sell me stuff over the years, right? And only, you know, a lot of people want to sell you stuff, and then after the sale, they're gone. And I try to work with companies and products that have a good reputation, have a good quality product, and are general dentist friendly. You know, are there to support you and your efforts. So I'm trying to bring more value to the general dentist who wants to get in the implant game, because just to get started in implantology, you know, can be $10,000 or $15,000, right? So if I can cut that cost in half and get you into to that for half the price, and kind of speed up your learning curve, not only do you have a better experience in implantology, you're probably going to place more implants eventually. You're probably going to grow faster in the field. You're going to stick with it, and I think I don't want people to get burned out on implantology because they had a bad experience, or they bought a bunch of expensive equipment and now it's sitting on the shelf and they're not using it. So I kind of want to show them the real path in the private practice of, hey, you know, if you're a general dentist, here's what you can do. Now I'm not here to say how far you have to go, but here's an opportunity, and let's find a path that's right for you. So maybe you're comfortable, you know, learning and just placing single implants, or maybe you just want to stick with the basics, or perhaps you want to go on and do full mouth restorations and become a diplomate of the AID. I want to be there to help guide people on that path, and get them with the correct resources, so that they're not wasting their time and money with systems and opportunities that don't work.
You know, I've had the privilege of kind of seeing behind the scenes with what you're developing with dental implant practices, and it's quite amazing. It's going to be an incredible resource with all kinds of features, as Philip mentioned. You know, an opportunity to have a buyer's club to be able to make savings on the common supplies and hardware that you'll be using, but also some awesome education in various formats, some bite-sized pieces, some just really great education is going to help you on the journey. And Phil, this is going to be a very cool resource. It's launching in the next little while. I mean, we're literally right on the eve of getting this thing launched, and excited to kind of debut it here on the podcast.
Yeah. You know, I'm really excited because I see a lot of people that will relate with this type of thing. You know, it's not going to break the bank. I mean, if you're going to end up placing, you know, three or four implants a month, it'll more than pay for itself. But the camaraderie that I'm trying to provide, and the opportunities that I'm trying to open up for people, I think are the exciting part for me, because, you know, my goal for this is to continue to expand what I'm doing. You know, I want to start doing more kind of webinars. I want to start getting into more recording surgeries and you know, possibly putting together maybe like a symposium type of event,
right?
That's focused on the general dentist's role in implantology and how you progress through that to get to that clinical level of, you know, mastership.
Or wherever they want to go.
Wherever they want to be, right? And so picking you up at where you're at now, helping figure out where you want to be, and then helping you find a path to get there that makes sense for people. And right. and they have a place they can go and trust and say, look, there's a lot of ways to go. Let's just find one that's right for you.
Right. Well, I know our listeners are going to be very interested to learn more. Would you go ahead and kind of provide the world premiere right here on the Thriving Dentist Show of your website address?
Yeah, so the website address is www.dentalimplantpractices.com, and that's going to be the hub of the whole dental implant practices platform. So on there, you're going to find, okay, we're still going to have the podcast, and that's going to go on every other week. And so we're going to continue to provide free content with the podcast. I'm going to continue to have the Facebook group, which is growing leaps and bounds.
By the way, what's the name of the Facebook group?
Dental Implant Practices. Yep. And it's a closed group on Facebook, but you know, I'm pretty lenient on who I let in. I just want to make sure they're in the dental field, so that we can share about dental implantology. And it's a mentorship group there. There's a lot of people putting up cases and sharing about best practices and, hey, you could do this, or have you used this lab, and kind of how to do things in the real world. So I can do a lot of teaching there.
I'll put in the show notes. So if you're driving, don't take your hands off the wheel. I'll put in the show notes, the website, dentalimplantpractices.com. I'll also put a link to the private Facebook page. So as you indicated, it's a closed group, but if they request entry, you'll let them in. But you'll have to approve that. So we'll put that in there. And then you did something very cool, Philip, for our listeners. You put together kind of a cool guide with all kinds of resources about just equipment, sequencing, and you've made that available to our listeners via an email. Talk a little bit more about what's in that guide, kind of a good way to kind of jump into implants.
Yeah, so I'm trying to put together how people can get into implantology, and you know, there's a lot of things they don't know about, but some of it's just the basics, right? And they don't know where to get the basics. So one of the guides I'm putting together is just kind of a coding and billing guide. It's what the codes are, a breakdown of description, and then an average fee schedule for you know, any town USA, right? So that at least you have a starting spot for, you know, the different language involved in implant dentistry. And then we're also going to be putting together some different starter packages, right? So if somebody wants to get some basic starter packages, we're going to have some different availability on that, so where they can just know what they need to get into implantology. Because it's, you know, it's kind of like you get into something else and you realize you don't know what you don't know. And, you know, getting in implantology, there's you know, these little bundles that we can put together to kind of get you ahead of the curve and not break the bank. So those are the two things we're working on. And I think people find that information a great resource. It's something I wish I'd had 10 years ago when I got started.
Yeah. You know. So to get that information, thank you, Phil, for putting that together for our listeners. To get that information, simply send him an email, and in the subject line, just write the word thriving. Thriving will be the clue that to Philip that you're interested in that coding and billing guide and those starter kit guides. And if you want to write him an email, if you want to write him a note, go ahead and write him. If not, just put thriving in the subject line. Philip, be kind enough to share your email address, if you would.
Yeah, so my email is phil@dentalimplantpractices.com. That's P-H-I-L @dentalimplantpractices.com. And that's my personal email. I reply to that. You know, I try to stay up with a lot of things. You know, I get anywhere from 5 to 50 Facebook messages a day about, you know, common things. You know, why did you do this on a case you posted, or what drill should I use for that? What kind of surgical guide would be best here? So, you know, I try to get back with people, but I do get bombarded with stuff. So just understand if I don't get back with you, maybe I missed it. So keep pushing me. I don't mind questions and inquiries. You know, I'm trying to, you know, trying to do some blogging, some writing about all the common things that, you know, people want to know. So I'm going to have that on the website too, so that I can just kind of give people all the information that I think that they need to get started. And then we'll just continue to expand from there, right? I think if we can just give people all the information and put them with the right people, they're going to be in a better spot than they would if they were just to try it on their own. And I think that's the goal here, is, you know, we can all kind of take care of each other in that regard.
Well, I'll put all three of those links in the show notes. The website, dentalimplantpractices.com, the Facebook mentorship page, also dental implant practices on Facebook, and then Philip's private email address. I'll put all that in the show notes. You can access those show notes at thrivingdentist.com. All that information will be right there. Well, Philip, I want to take a minute and say thanks, man. Thanks for all that you're doing. Thanks for being a catalyst for the next generation of implant dentists. Thanks for taking that position of, hey, if I would have known this 10 years ago, this is what I would have done. And thanks for all that you do, man. It's cool stuff.
Yeah. You know, I'm excited about what I'm doing because I know that there's people out there that have the same passion that I do, right? And maybe they're ahead of me and maybe they're behind me. And I'm always excited to talk to people about dentistry and implant dentistry and how we can, better the field for everybody. So it's something I feel real passionate about, and I love talking with people about it. So if anybody wants to get a hold of me, I'm always available.
Well, I really appreciate your spirit of helpfulness. I know it comes from the heart, and really appreciate all that you're doing for your colleagues. Hey, I also want to take a minute and thank you as a listener to the Thriving Dentist Show. We appreciate you, each and every one of you. There's three things you can do to support our work. Number one, you can tell a colleague about the podcast. As many dentists have never heard the word podcast, share it with them. And hey, tell them about mine, Thriving Dentist Show, and also tell them about Gordon's or Phillips, Dental Implant Practices podcast. Tell them about Phillips. Secondly, you can jump on iTunes and write us a review. If you write a review on iTunes, it functions very much like a Google review functions for your practice, helps people find us. The third thing that you can do is you can hit the subscribe button. So if you like the podcast, hit subscribe. You can do that on iTunes. You can do that on Google Play or whatever your podcast directory of choice is. On that note, let me simply say thank you. Thank you for the privilege of your time, and tell you that I will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.